day of Lent, and to be here again in Fairfield, New Jersey. And the epistle for this second Sunday of Lent is taken from St. Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 4. Brethren, we pray and beseech thee, we beseech you, in the Lord Jesus, that as you have received of us how you ought to walk and to please God, so also you would walk, that you may abound the more. For you know what precepts I have given to you by the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, not of the passion of lust, like the Gentiles that know not God, and that no man overreacheth nor desire his brother, deceive his brother in business, because the Lord is the avenger of all these things, as we have told you before, and have testified. For God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto sanctification in Christ Jesus our Lord. And the gospel, let's take from that according to St. Matthew, chapter 17. At that time Jesus took Peter and James and John, his brother, and bringeth him up into a high mountain apart. And he was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his garments became white as snow. And behold, there appeared to him Moses and Elias talking with him. And Peter answering said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. And as he was yet speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And lo, a voice out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And the disciples hearing fell upon their face and were very much afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said to them, Arise and fear not. And they lifting up their eyes saw no one but only Jesus. And as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, Tell the vision of no man, till the Son of Man be risen from the dead. Thus far the words of today's Holy Gospel. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Amen. So today, the second Sunday in the season of Lent. And the miracle consideration today is the feast of the transfiguration of our Lord. And that we're reminded in this transfiguration that it is not a miracle of Christ. It was just simply the normal state of his body. That his normal state would be his light shining forth from his face, his garments as white as snow, and very resplendent in glory. But that our Lord hid this from the eyes of his apostles and the others of men. The miracle is that he hid his glory. Not that he was able to show it, but he allowed his apostles to see his glory. And it reminds us of a few dogmas of our faith. And one of them is that God shows himself to all men. Every man will know that God is God. Every man is going to run into the truth. As it says in the sacred scripture, Dixit incipiens in cordo suo non est Deus. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. Everyone is going to run into God. Every single person. But not everyone is going to see inside of God. Not everyone is going to see his glory. Because in order to see inside of God, you have to get past the first step. You have to first agree to follow his laws. Agree to follow him and to love, know, love, and serve him minimally. Then we go to the next level of knowledge, the next level of loving, the next level of serving, and that along the way, God gives consolations. And he gives consolations to those that know and love him. Even though we will all experience struggles, there shall be consolations. And so, but today, a consideration of one of the mysteries of the consideration of yesterday on the Ember Days. And on the Ember Day of yesterday, we consider that may God show forth his glory to the nations. May the nations see, may the Gentiles see the glory of God, and may they see the power of God. That one of the prayers of the church, one of the prayers of David, King David, the author of the Psalms, the prayers of the saints is to smash and punish and destroy the enemies of God. Remember that there will be a day of judgment. In fact, the day of judgment is coming soon for our people and our nation. And there must be a day of judgment, and the Catholics and those who love God desire the day of judgment. Now, there are two judgments that come upon man, either the judgment of the mercy of God or the judgment of the justice of God. And this judgment comes on the day of our death. Those who do not know, love, and serve God, live in the state of mortal sin, do not take God above other things, they shall give glory to God by experiencing the judgment of his justice. Those who have repented of their sins, they shall give glory to God by showing the judgment of his mercy. And man does not only, a man who loves God, does not only desire the salvation of the just, he also desires the damnation of the damned. That those who are in this life, every man in this life, until the moment of death, he has a possibility of repentance. Therefore, we desire his repentance. But those who refuse to repent, what do we desire about them? And here it is made clear in the Psalms, the just man shall wash his feet in the blood of sinners. The just man shall wash his feet in the blood of sinners, says King David. And here we say that when you walk upon the dead body of the sinner, it will trample him and wash his feet in his blood. There shall be no sorrow for the death of the sinner. There shall be no sorrow for the damned. And God said to Jeremiah the prophet, pray not for this people, for I will not hear thee. Because since the beginning of time, one of the lies of the devil is that God still loves the damned. And God is still merciful to those who reject his mercy unto the end. And God is so good and so merciful and so loving that when someone dies an enemy of God and does not change his heart at the moment of the death and the final judgment, that person shall be brought, his suffering shall be brought to an end because of the goodness in God. So that hell will come to an end, and judgment will come to an end, and God will say, I forgive you to those that have hated him at the moment of death. Well, not only will God not forgive them, he shall rejoice in their suffering. As it says in the sacred scripture concerning the damned, I shall laugh when that shall fall upon you which you have feared, it says in the book of wisdom. And that God is going to laugh when that would falls upon them what they feared. The man that lives in sin fears hell. The man that lives in sin fears the wrath of God. And the wrath of God is going to come upon him. And when it comes, there shall not be any sorrow in the just. And we desire that those who have died, those who do not repent, and died the enemies of God, they shall meet the justice of God. St. Thomas Aquinas says, no man can love without hate. If you love God, you necessarily hate his permanent enemy, the devil. If you love good, you necessarily hate evil. And St. Thomas says, you can never have love without hate. And you can never have the rejoicing in good without the despising and sorrow at the presence of evil. And when evil is crushed and evil is destroyed, this causes a rejoicing in the just. Because there are some heretics and some wicked souls who say that the just shall feel sorry for the damned. There shall be no feeling sorry for the damned. We hope those that are living in the state of mortal sin today are going to repent. But if they do not repent, they shall be crushed. And why shall they be crushed? And why do we rejoice in their being crushed? The reason is quite simple. The glory of the name of God. Let not thy name be spit upon. Let not thy name be destroyed. And God shall not allow his name to be destroyed. And remember thy holiness. Remember, just like we say in the Dies Irae on the positive side. Lord, I am a sinner, it says in the Dies Irae, and I have offended you. And I am sorry for my sins. But don't let your redemption be in vain. And remember, for the sake of your redemption, to forgive me my sins. But it is also true on the flip side, that those who are unrepentant, they shall be punished, they shall be crushed, and God must take vengeance. And therefore he saith, vengeance is mine, I shall repay. The nations, the Gentiles, those that have turned against God and have spit upon God, turned to false gods, turned to the seven capital sins, turned against the Ten Commandments, turned against the virtues of faith, hope, and charity, and prudence, justice, temperance, and fortitude, and have not repented in their turning against these things, though God has given us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to repent, the time will come when God brings down his justice. God cannot be God if he only has love and if he only forgives. The forgiveness and the love mean nothing if he does not prove his love by punishing those that love not. If he doesn't prove the power of his forgiveness by refusing to forgive those who are not sorry. There is a condition of forgiveness. Now, when souls refuse to repent, they are to be punished by God, and they shall receive the judgment of God, and the just rejoice. When we hear that the enemies of God are destroyed, when we hear that the friends of God have won a victory, this causes joy for the just. When we experience suffering from the unjust souls, we rejoice because the suffering is a benefit to our souls. Their suffering gives us a place in heaven. And then when the enemies who have brought about wickedness, when they are punished, we rejoice that they are punished. Hence, it is noted everywhere in the lives of the saints that the predominant condition or the predominant state of this just man is one of joy. He has joy because he has God in his heart. He has joy because God has taken away his sins. And if he's in sin, he's going to give them to God and he's going to repent of those sins. And he also has joy because the enemies of God, they shall only be his enemies and be able to do evil against God for a very short time. And then that time shall come to an end. And all those that have done evil against God, all the evil shall be righted. Those that repent, the blood of Christ wipes away that evil. Those that do not repent, the fire of hell justly punishes that evil. And therefore justice of God shall always have its victory. The mercy of God shall always have its victory, and that we therefore rejoice not only at the good of those repenting, but rejoice at the punishment of those that are damned. The Catholic does not only desire everyone to go to heaven. We do desire everyone to go to heaven. But if they refuse God, and if they do not repent, and they reach that moment of judgment, then all those that are actually in the state of damnation when they die, their damnation is wished. And that we don't know who is damned and who is not damned. And since we do not know, we therefore hope for the salvation of all men. And we hope for that each man repents, and God alone knows who has repented. But those who have not repented, they must experience the judgment of God, and the just rejoice in that experience of his judgment. So that the souls in heaven shall be happy because they're with God. They shall be happy because all the souls that have been the effects of the mercy of God and are seeing and washing their souls in the blood of the Lamb, like it says in the book of Apocalypse. But when they see the damned in hell, there shall not be a drop of sorrow upon the just. They shall see the damned in hell, and they shall rejoice that the damned are damned, and the equal joy that they rejoice that the just are saved. And there shall not be the drop of tears of any kind for those that are eternally damned by the justice of God. The time of tears is only here on earth. The time of tears is here. This is the time to have tears. This is the time to beg forgiveness. This is the time to ask for the salvation of God to enter out to every soul. But those who reject it, they shall be rejected themselves and also forever. So in any case, in this feast, this time of Lent, the Transfiguration, remember that God shows himself his glory to St. Peter and to St. James and St. John, so that when the time comes after the resurrection and they truly understand the glory of the Transfiguration, it will give them strength to be able to go through the tribulations of life. God allows us to have consolations, gives us consolations to give us strength to persevere through the tribulations. And also, consolations are not only going to be given in heaven, they will also be given here on earth as we travel on our journey towards God. We will experience sufferings, but we must also experience consolations, and God will give them to us. God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.